Coming from a family that has been dealing in automobile sector for many years, his passion was to start a restaurant on his own, and that's what he has done with the Daryaganj restaurants. And of course, let's invite on stage Shri Saurish Bhattacharyaji, curator of IIHE 2021 awards and conferences. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. You know, you all have traveled long distances. Anurag has come all the way from Mumbai. You know, Amit, you live somewhere, of course, midway, you know. So you know, I don't know from where you came, but or which Daryaganj you have come from. Okay. Uday Taino has come from a very long distance again, from Gurgaon. So thank you very much to come on this rainy day and, you know, join us. We are very happy to have you here. I'm very sorry that we have begun exactly 1 hour late. Normally, I'm not used to such delays, but, you know, unfortunately, you know, our the new association was formed and there was a lot of excitement about that. I guess it's understandable, you know. The discussion today is on, you know, what is the future in the post-COVID world for the restaurants, you know. And as we were talking to Anurag and I were talking, and he said that during his tenure as NRAI president, you know, he started with logout and then went into lockdown. And I think even in Maharashtra, from where you come, the lockdown is still more or less in force. So Anurag, let's begin. What has changed about the restaurant business after COVID sort of left us and, you know, we sort of picked up the threads?
So I think what has happened really is that the restaurant industry has gone for a complete change. I think the biggest fallacy that we have is that we believe that whatever was relevant or whatever was the benchmark in the pre-COVID times remains in our head. Like me and Amit were just talking, we are X percentage of pre-COVID numbers. I think that's something which is...
What is the percentage? You know, I hear different things.
It varies, but city to city. Mumbai, for example, is still working with 50% capacity till 10 p.m. only. So obviously the numbers are not as good as, let's say, Gurgaon, which is working till 1:30 p.m. But by and large, there is a good bounce back. There is no doubt about it. But you know, from a restaurateur's perspective, I draw lots of positivity as well. If you ask me, all my colleagues here will agree that we have all been, thanks to the lockdown, we were all able to prune down our business models and made it much more leaner, much more fitter, much more robust. Because over the years, lots of girth got accumulated as we grew, and we got a chance to correct that. Going forward, I think things are looking bright. You have to definitely reimagine your business and business models. There is no two ways about it, because the consumption trends have changed. If you take a few key segments within F&B, like a bar or a banquet, catering, they have not taken off as well because of the current restrictions. A bar, you know, whatever works for a bar is an anathema for the COVID protocol. Everything from crowd to, you know, close proximity, etc., etc. But at the same time, very clearly, like a segment for home deliveries have grown quite a lot. Profitably or not is a different story. I'm not getting.
In fact, I'll come to the home deliveries very soon because I can see, you know, Amit smiling because he's invested a lot in home deliveries, and so have you.
No.
By the way, I just want to set the record right. You're the founder and managing director of Indigo Hospitality.
Yes.
I know there is very little distance between hospitality and hospitals, but still, we should maintain that respectable distance.
The only thing is the component of service remains common to both.
Yeah, exactly.
They're two different things.
Now, right, right.
Khana are two different
things. Right.
So, just coming to the delivery bit, see, that has emerged as one of the business segments that is largely insulated against these restrictions in a way. So I think, if I have to put it in a nutshell, relook at your business models. Don't set yourself against what was relevant pre-COVID. If you think in current scenario, I can only generate, let's say, 50 lakhs of business, work your business model to make sure you're profitable at 50, saying, पहले तो मैं 80 करता था, मैं 80 के हिसाब से खर्चे रखूंगा. That is completely rubbish. Complete rubbish. Number two, be real about whatever is happening in the market. Don't live in this fool's paradise once upon a time. That's history. And thirdly, look at, be very nimble on whatever is happening in the market and make the best use of it. No point crying. Whatever opportunities are there, make the best use of it. As restaurateurs, what we do is very simple. We offer hospitality laced with food and whatever. Now, formats are irrelevant to that. So just be robust on that. And I think we have good days ahead. जब तक कोई दवा नहीं बनेगी लोग खाना खाने जाते रहेंगे.
राइट, एग्जैक्टली. सो यू नो अमित, व्हाट इज योर, यू नो अमित बाय द वे इज द फाउंडर एंड मैनेजिंग एंड सीईओ ऑफ, को फाउंडर एंड सीईओ ऑफ दरियागंज रेस्टोरेंट्स. दरियागंज रेस्टोरेंट्स हैव यू रियली रिवाइव्ड यू नो व्हाट आई कॉल्ड पोस्ट पार्टीशन पंजाबी क्विजीन इन दिल्ली. यू नो दैट्स अ जॉनर इन इटसेल्फ. एंड यू नो ऑफ कोर्स everyone knew about Moti Mahal and you've drawn inspiration from Moti Mahal. But tell me, you know, we heard Anurag talking about, you know, how business models have to change. So you started about 2 years ago. In these 2 years, I mean, you started at the best of, in the best of times, and you saw the worst of times. So in these 2 years, what changes have come about in your business model?
Yes, it's been a major, you know, it's been a very learning time for us, a big learning time. So like I started this brand 28 months back in April 2019, and before even our first anniversary, March, we had the first lockdown and COVID happened. And that time we had just opened our second restaurant. We were about to open two more, which was Gurgaon and Pacific Mall, and the lockdown happened. So suddenly it was a big you know, disappointment. But a lot of that was a big learning period for me personally also. I personally also had that so much time to analyze a lot of data, to learn how, you know, we could do better with data analytics. That was the only thing we were sitting at home and we had that time. So I took a lot of time into analyzing a lot of data of my restaurants. What happens there, what is sale, what is the sales mix, what are the customer, what is the, and what time slots, what customers used to come, and where, what kind of a team I have. So, I mean, it's been a big learning for us in the restaurant industry. Biggest cost is the manpower cost. We always used to be a little higher than usual. Today we are all at the same revenue. In fact, touch wood, for my same stores, we had done about 127% of our pre-COVID revenue. We have surpassed our pre-COVID revenue.
So that's very good news. So, I mean,
and the same revenue.
He should be in a DLF mall soon.
We just opened in DLF.
Oh, really? Okay, you have just opened.
And the best part was, with the similar revenues, our manpower cost is now 30% less. Because earlier we used to maybe hire extra, you know, we used to be little, now we become very frugal. So like I analyze every single hour of my boss, what data, at this hour, how many people come? So if I saw that in that hour, maybe only one table comes for 2 hours, why should I keep three people standing there? Maybe I'll move around them, the shifts, and get the best maximum out of it. I made an innovative way to, you know, like my staff, I hired them, I said 3 days you come this outlet, 3 days you go to the other outlet, or maybe, you know, even hire them part-time. I make sure no one goes without a job in the worst COVID times. But we plan very intelligently that we can plan the manpower well.
A lot of your staff also started delivering.
So I mean, the biggest learning was how you can reduce our cost, optimize our costs, and, you know, obviously to push our revenue. So that was very big learning.
So your revenues went up by 127% of the pre-COVID levels, and your manpower costs went down by 30%.
Yes, manpower still went down. So that was, we were all, you know, in the restaurant industry, we used to be very, you know, I think.
Yeah, I think.
This is what I call reimagining the business. Yeah. You know, whatever was relevant is not relevant now. Okay. It's working very well with 20%
less. Right.
My corporate team. I made a very corporate, lean corporate team. I you know, let 4-5 out of my 15 people go. Yeah. I became the CMO myself. I took up a lot of roles myself. let me.
Anyway, you were the CMO. You know, even when you had a CMO,
yeah, roles I took up myself. And, you know, lean team was giving better results. We realized that. That's also been a big benefit.
So in journalism, we have the saying that the leaner the team, the more productivity you have. You know,
exactly.
So we always work on that principle.
Yes.
Of course. So So some people have to really sweat it out, you know. So yes. But anyway, then. So
and overall, it's been a big digital transformation of the business which I've been trying to do, and that has helped me get the best results, you know, because we have the technology at, available to us, with the data analytics available to us.
In fact, I will come to that bit because Anurag has done a lot of work in that area. And Anurag will talk a lot about that, the digital transformation you have brought around. You know? So, Udit, now tell me, in this business, you know, you have I was asking you on WhatsApp that which part of the DLF empire do you head, you know, because DLF, F&B is so big. I mean, you're in the business of service, you're actually delivering food, and in the sense you're serving food, and you're also the landlord of restaurants, you know. So how are the two businesses working out, you know, because say in a place like Mumbai, or in most malls, now you have a double vaccination norm, that people have to show a certificate to enter. How has that affected your business?
So thank you for this panel firstly. Luckily for us, I mean, we look forward to actually having more partners. Today we have north of 200 partners, it's just in F&B, and that's how I had the entire division for DLF across all assets. As far as the government protocols have been concerned, we've obviously been following them, and luckily Delhi and Gurgaon have been more lenient than Bombay has been, which has kind of obviously helped in sales. Although we still aren't at the projected numbers what we were pre-COVID, but luckily there's so much demand in the past 1.5 years of this entire turmoil that a lot of customers have come back to our malls for shopping, for dining. I have a core belief that eating out is a part of your core social fabric, and that's just not going to change in spite of enough online shopping, etc. So even as a group, we are very focused on F&B as a whole, by getting new concepts, and luckily the shoppers and the people coming to our malls, like some of my assets are already beyond pre-COVID numbers, especially in Gurgaon, like Noida, they just lifted their weekend lockdown very recently, and I see Noida climbing back again. Amit is a customer and a partner.
There is a bit of a revenge shopping or revenge dining happening, you know?
If I talk about revenge shopping, then that's happening the best in luxury. We've always seen that, and luxury across our malls are doing extremely well. But even in dining, I think people were fed up of just eating at home or cooking beyond a point. And restaurants, especially our assets where people are vaccinated completely in my malls, and they feel safe and secure to come to a very broadly safe environment in the circumstances that we are, and enjoy a good meal. So that definitely translates to good amount of sales, even though we had restricted numbers in terms of timeline. But I am seeing good numbers with sustainable products as of now.
So tell me about Mumbai. You know, Mumbai remains a problem, Mumbai and Pune, you know, because of the restriction on hours and restriction. 10 o'clock, that 10 o'clock bar that you have.
So yeah, Bombay as a whole, yes, because what we are seeing in Bombay, and Anurag and you were just chatting on that as well, was the double vaccination, which is currently a government protocol to kind of enter these malls. And also Bombay very recently extended the 4 p.m. deadline until 10 p.m. It was one of the last days to do that. So I'm sure business-wise, I think Anuragji will give you a better perspective. But yes, in terms of business, I think Delhi, Gurgaon, for example, could do better numbers than Bombay, and Bombay would be facing that challenge.
Okay, I'll come to, of course, DLF's expansion, because you had very ambitious F&B expansion plans, you know, yes. Pre-COVID, you know. I'll come to
sure.
That. Anurag, you know, you were talking about home deliveries, you know, and you yourself have got into the business of cloud kitchens. And when you won, the NRAI president, which was just like 2 weeks ago, you know, and now you're a trustee of the association. You were the leader of the movement called Go Direct, you know? and you also went to competition commission against Zomato and Swiggy, you know. So now tell me how successful has Go Direct been? Tell me more about it, and you know, about the cloud kitchen business. Is it taking off? Is it here to stay? Is it making money?
So to answer you, cloud kitchen is here to stay, and it is going to be profitable as well going forward. Right now the problem is cloud kitchen has become synonymous with cheap eating. That's not what a cloud kitchen should be. It is about what I call uncomplicated, unpretentious, good food coming to your house, well packaged, that you can consume in the comforts of your house. Now that is changing slowly and slowly. If you see with the lockdown, many renowned restaurateurs have gotten into this business. I am launching a brand called Platform 7 by Indigo somewhere next month, and I will be launching about 5 brands for the delivery only business. Having said that,
I think like AD Singh was talking about launching a pizza brand. He has Zoravar Kalra is launching his burger brand. Riyaz Amlani has already launched his burger.
Everybody has gotten into this business.
Gauri Devi Dayal is in it.
So because see, end of the day, we are entrepreneurs in the food and beverage space. Wherever we see a sunshine, it is prudent to invest there and work over there. So I think where the anomaly is right now, even when we were talking about Zomato, Swiggy, and I know I get asked this question everywhere I go, I have always maintained,
You're not known as the anti-Zomato crusader.
No, nothing like that.
Digital landlords, as you call them, you know?
No, I call them digital landlords for a reason, Sarishda. Please understand, I am never against delivery. I am not against Zomato or Swiggy. What I am concerned about is the current terms of engagement with them. They are very lopsided, one-sided, and working on them, you can never make money. And I'm not here, as long as I'm registered with the registrar of company and not the charity commissioner, I will not work on those terms with Zomato or Swiggy. And that is where my concern is. They have done a fabulous job in expanding the delivery business base in India. I give the credit to them. They have created discovery, triggered discovery for lots of startup brands. I give them full credit. But if I'm doing business with you and I am losing money, you are losing a pot full of money, year-round discount means government is losing money, then who is winning in all this? This is basically a flawed business model. This is what we want Competition Commission of India to investigate, what we have told them to. So I think there is a lot more. But at the same time, I must say the Order Direct campaign that NRAI initiated a few months back is having a very, very good traction. In my own company, now we are doing almost a quarter of our business through direct deliveries. And I have not even been very, very, what I call, focused about it, so to say, on building it. I will be doing that now with the launch of my own delivery kitchen. But this is the reality, that this is a new way of consuming food. It is here to stay. Good entrepreneurs will get into the trade. This whole business will see an upgradation, and either the terms of engagement with the aggregators will change or the aggregators will change.
Right. Okay. That's very important, you know, what you said. I have, of course, some more related questions, but I'll come to that later. Amit, you sort of got into the delivery business also, and You always made it a bespoke business. I mean, like each of your delivery boxes themselves must have cost quite a fortune, you know. So tell me, how did you manage it, and you know, how successful has your experience been? You know?
So yeah, when we started our restaurants 2.5 years back, I never ever planned to do delivery.
Right.
My concept was the selling the experience, not just the food. So I never thought of delivery as a plan. But then, you know, when COVID happened, we all had to change every plan we had. So we had to do, in the first lockdown, we didn't do any delivery. The second time when it happened, we continued with our restaurants and we continued with the delivery. And when we opened back again, after the second lockdown, delivery was contributing about 35% of our sales, which was very good at that time. And then slowly now it's come down to 15%, but the numbers remain the same. But dine-in has grown as a number, but delivery as a number is same. So this not delivery has not gone down in spite of dine-in going up.
It's in comparison with dining, because in-house dining has gone up. You know?
So my dine-in is going up, but delivery is same. So yeah, it's not going down.
So in comparison to that, the percentage has gone down.
Yeah. So if I was doing 100 rupees the business and delivery was 30 and 170 was dine-in, 30 is still there. The 70 has become 140, but then 30 is still there.
Right.
So what is happening now? What is that? Delivery is here to stay, and delivery is not just all about cheap and cheap food available at your house. Like I said, It's all about experience also. Like, you created a business experience called Five Senses Delivery.
Right.
And it was about how you can touch the five senses of a customer at their house. And
you
know,
actually, you had the perfume that you
use.
The
box comes with a welcome note, which is perfumed with the brand's fragrance. Mm-hmm. Then even the songs of the brand are playing immediately when you put your phone in front of the QR code.
Yeah.
The brand music starts playing. So complete experience taken back to the home. People appreciate these kind of experiences.
So what is your average order value?
Average order value for us is about 1400. Yeah.
That's, I think it's pretty good.
We were in top five.
The cheap business model doesn't work
here. So we were in top five in Zomato in terms of numbers for North Indian restaurants as well during the lockdown time. Yeah. And people have appreciated. So I mean, there is a market for little premium Indian food, premium food as well.
Right.
But usually the biggest market lies in that 700 APC is a big market. But this is a small chunk of the market, maybe 10-15%, but we'd rather be in that than be in
So you don't change number, you don't change volumes, you change value.
But we don't save anything, actually, very rightly said. When you're doing only delivery, and Zomato Swiggy takes your 20% commission, you're always losing money. You never make money.
That's why you should now move to order director. What is this? Why is Zomato Swiggy?
Absolutely, absolutely. Mm-hmm. And eventually understand, people are consuming your product. They are not consuming a technology. Technology is a mean to consume your product. So please accord the best of the premium on your product. You don't have to be cheap and cheerful all the time. You please attach value to what you're serving.
Yeah, I think this came up earlier also when we were talking to the breakfast served in hotels, you know, sort of that's. Now, Udit, talking about DLF, you know, there was a lot of uncertainty about landlords, and you know, it's a very, very sensitive question. But as a landlord, you know, what has DLF done in this COVID time?
Sorry, I'd like to answer this question.
Yeah, yeah, okay.
Sorry, you heard this. I met Mr. Rajiv Singh as well very recently, and I told him, thank you for saving the industry. Because he was the first DLF. The big, you know, question mark, what's going to happen now when we were reopening our restaurants.
Exactly, right.
And you know, everyone was, all the landlords were raising bills and things were happening.
Right.
Suddenly we see a news in the newspaper that DLF announces they're giving a waiver to all their tenants for the lockdown.
Right.
And immediately everyone followed.
Right.
So that was a big, you know, lead they took and a big, a big...
So good. You know, I was hoping Udit will talk about it, but you've done his work already. So now, how has that helped you? You know, in fact, this is quite a model for landlords to follow. I mean, for mall owners to follow. How has that helped you?
As I said, with the number of partners that we have in F&B as a whole, we treat them as much as family like we are. We need to grow together in this business. And yes, they
you have 200 restaurant brands.
Actually, more than 200. I think they'll be around 230.
230, okay. And how many other retail brands do you have?
That will run into a multiplier number. I have to really calculate. DLF as a whole, we have a very strong presence across India, especially in the north. We have the leading malls across Delhi. As far as just COVID is
18 malls across Delhi NCR.
Not 18, as in leading. As far as just rentals are concerned, COVID was a time which none of us predicted out here. DLF was in the forefront to give the best support to all our partners and work together in this entire uncertain time. And we continue to do that. And that's, so what's helped, got that going for us is that today we can focus on F&B as a whole, create and bet on new concepts which can definitely last. Like for example, Amit has just opened up a restaurant with us in Mall of India. And we know for a fact that these concepts, though it's a new concept, it has the entire bandwidth to last 6 to 9 years ahead, and probably even more, because the food and the entire story around it is great. So when you give your own partners enough support and a holding hand that you work together, you not only don't lose business yourself, but you open new doors as well.
Amit, you're in the neighborhood. That's why you're so excited about coming here,
I was there only at Mall of India today.
Good, good. Congratulations, So this is your sixth outlet.
Fifth outlet. We have the fifth outlet.
So that's very good.
We've signed this property during COVID. It's like the London lockdown.
Wow, good, good. So that only shows how people and mall owners have to work together. I mean, the restaurants, after all, give revenue bring in revenue to malls.
We got the comfort from DLF. They said, you don't worry, we are work like partners. We signed and we took the plunge that time when no one was even thinking of expansion. We signed.
And I remember, Anurag, you at least 3 or 4 press releases I remember reading of yours where you were beating your heads about landlord. What has been your experience, you know?
No, I think, let me soften what you said. All I did was, I said, if we have to save the industry, everybody in the ecosystem have to come together and work to save the industry, and our landlords are a very critical part of our ecosystem. What I told them was, rather than dealing with everybody, if you want, I am happy to play the role of the middlemen, if I may call it, to come up with certain, you know, larger understanding on how it will work. See, Dada, I am very clear. The relationship between a landlord and a restaurant is like that of a stage and a performer. We both need each other. A mall is a stage which requires retailers to keep itself busy, and a restaurant is a performer which needs a stage to show his ability. And if we work from that mindset, I don't see a problem. And I must say that most of the landlords across the nation were very, very supportive, at least during the first lockdown. Second lockdown, it was not as structured, but still people, like I personally have no qualms with any of my landlords. They all worked with me.
Right, and then Bombay has seen the worst of the lockdown, you know, scenario, you know, so.
Yes. Sometimes the financial capital also sees a lockdown.
That's right.
A city that never sleeps is not allowed to step out.
Yeah, that's right. You know, that is so true. So, Udit, coming to DLF, you know, look, you have got brands like Sets. Of course, Sets is undergoing a transformation. You have got brands like MKT, which is my favorite, personal favorite, you know. Great place, you know, Anurag, I don't know whether you've been to MKT at Chanakya. MKT in Chanakya. You must visit the place. Okay, great. So, what are your next F&B plans, you know? And, you know, because you're both a landlord and a restaurant operator, how do you manage the two roles? You know?
So when it comes to restaurant operator, yes, we do have MKT, Chashi and Cafe E and Cafe C amongst a little other portfolio that we have. That's in certain assets of ours, and we like to keep the focus limited as far as that's concerned. Our focus going forward definitely is in rebranding a large part of so-called mall assets to do with F&B. The first asset that we've done in Delhi is a marquee development called Commons at DLF Avenue Saket, where from ground first, second, all levels are all F&B throughout. It's one of India's first developments to be just F&B centric.
That's like a cyber hub in Delhi. Or how do you, because I've been to DLF Avenue, unfortunately I went there just before the lockdown. And then the lockdown happened and I haven't gone back since.
So Cyber Hub, when we made it in 2013, it was complementing to the office audience in Gurgaon. This is actually an entire wing of a mall, which is ground first, second, all F&B. Going forward, our bet is on any new concept, people who are passionate about the product, very importantly, but new concepts who have the sustainability with us. In a mall, there's a very broad audience from different parts of society coming in. We need to cater to them as a whole, focus on making money together. You know, we have great partners. Anurag ji has always been a partner with us in the past. Amit is a partner with us right now. So definitely take bets on projects which have a long-term sustainability with us, long-term growth, yet give the customer something new as well. Like Amit's restaurant is something Indian food packaged so differently with the story that people have really appreciated it. As far as Delhi goes concerned,
his butter chicken, you know, now is, I think, the best in Delhi, you know. So, you know, Delhi NCR. I don't know about Bombay, but.
Bombay doesn't know butter chicken, they only know their butter. And pow.
Yeah, that's right. Bun maska is the big
Bombay
thing.
Bombay is known for his sweet butter chicken, which is not in Delhi, fortunately.
It's very good that, you know, brands like Daryaganj are coming in, you know. That you are actually, opening up to young brands. This is just a 28-month-old brand, you know. Anurag comes with a bigger history. Indigo, in its old avatar, has a long history. Now, under Anurag, you know, enter a new the realm of business. So, there are a new part of its history. So, you know, it's, what about your Emporio brand? You know, you're opening more Emporios in Gurgaon, and I'm sure you'll have great F&B outlets there. You know, so are you going to now occupy a big space in the luxury dining area?
You know,
what?
So fundamentally, I'm a strong believer that you know, smaller concepts tend to do really well. That can be a cafe, that can be a restaurant. When I say smaller, that's 2 to 3,000 square feet roughly. Luxury, yes, does have a fine line associated to it, and there is a market in Delhi which does enjoy that. In malls going forward, whether we are doing it or we are tying up with somebody to do it, be it in the existing development or new one, we will focus on all appealing to a large audience again, but the luxury audience, and that's at the same time. But yes, concepts, new concepts, either from India or from abroad. I'm already discussing a few people who are from abroad who want to do new concepts with us in the luxury space. Happy to entertain those conversations, and that's exactly where you're going.
I hope you know, you find some people here who want to invest.
Happy to have that connection made for
you. Yeah. So, you know, Anurag, you know, because we have people from the education sector here, you know, and, you know, a lot of people, I've heard a lot of restaurateurs say that the IHMs, for instance, they're not actually sort of teaching people about restaurants. And restaurants are a different kettle of fish, you know. So what is your advice to people in the education sector running IHMs or similar institutions?
I think the curriculum at the IHMs are still what we learned 30 years ago. They haven't changed quite substantially while the world has moved on. I think it is very important that the industry and the educators work together to create the kind of study that the current batch needs to. I think our focus has been too much into hotels, and a bit of a F&B and all. I would quote Theodore Levitt or somebody had said, the component of hospitality is there in every trade. Only the degree changes. And that is why I feel a student of hotel management today has his or her avenue far beyond just the hotels or the restaurants. And I think that is where educators will have to make it more current. And I think as an individual, as NRAI, I am happy to offer our assistance in creating a course material which is more relevant than what it is today. It is very important. They are creating the pipeline of talent. And imagine if the pipeline is of a better quality than what it is today. Right. It is only going to help the trade. It's a very small price to pay for it.
It shouldn't be clogged with old ideas. It should be an open pipeline which is in sync with the times, you know. So Amit, you know, you're a young professional, you know, you come from outside the industry, and now you're running, you're very much part of the industry. What is your opinion about what should be what is the talent pool that restaurateurs are looking for? What kind of skills are you looking for?
So yes, so we are, you know, our business is a totally people driven business. In fact, it's a very, very, you know, today the biggest challenge is to find good people in for our restaurants. So I thought, you know, I can talk for myself. I've taken things in my own hand. I'm trying to develop my own training program. I've got some whatever team I'm going to hire now. I'm getting the psychometric tests done, so I can at least pick up things where I need to work on with them and where their weaknesses lie. So that is very helps. Can you do a psychometric test and understand what the person is, you know, good at, what he's not good at, and, you know, make sure that he's in the right place when he's working. And as far as the young generation coming up, I think you know, we, like Anurag just said, it's very good. It'd be a very good thing if we can create something which is a very practical program, not something which is more theoretical. It also has to be practical at some the point of time. And, you know, give them, I feel if today if I hire someone, I don't even consider whether the person is from a hotel school or not. Whether he has a right attitude is the most important. If he has a good attitude, he will learn.
I think, as I say, that you cannot teach attitude, you know. You can't teach to a person how to smile, you know. So you know, Udit, what about brands like yours? You know, you're very big. You're retail giants, you know. in a sense, you know. And so what kind of people are you hiring? I believe you have hired a lot of people from the hotel industry or the F&B sector.
So how our teams are laid out, even we believe in having lean teams for sure, to have good productivity. But we have assets which are obviously large, which require people to manage them for sure.
So per asset, you know, how many people would you have running it?
You know, how we divide our asset is me and Ms. Bector, we all are part of the central team, which is obviously overseeing everything as a whole. But all our malls are self-sustained because we have our center head, which is a mall head. Usually they are from a hospitality background, but nothing specific that they have to be hospitality. But yes, a lot of my malls have people who have backgrounds of Taj, ITC, etc., who now run the entire mall for us.
In fact, the joke about the DLF is that you've cleaned out Oberoi. Every Oberoi general manager is now with you.
No, I didn't want to, I didn't miss Oberoi on purpose, but yes, there is a certain amount of hospitality background with us because this is a customer interaction profile. So they do come with that.
In fact, Debu Bharma has now taken, has joined you. So I mean, he's like the lead there, and you know, down below, how many? At least I know about 10 ex-Oberoi people who are there. You know,
I think a little more than that now would be. But
so probably Dada, Oberoi produces the best, and DLF hires the best.
But that's a good line.
That's the right way to put it for sure. But yeah, beyond my center heads, we have operations teams all below them. So again, there'll be a mix of people from hospitality, hotels, or just the real estate background as a whole. It'll be tough for me to quantify exactly how many people are there per mall, but yeah, the teams are very, very vast.
So I guess going forward, hotel management institutes have to have a module on restaurant management and retail and mall management.
Of course, you know, to their point, what Anurag-ji also made, to really have the courses more relevant. And as Amit said, to make it more practical as well. I mean, one is obviously theoretical learning, but you know, people should definitely get a hands-on feel of what it's like to probably run a restaurant or be a part of the kitchen or, you know, run the operations of a mall. I mean, those are skills you need to learn, kind of being more practical.
Anurag, I always give you the last word, you know, so what are your thoughts as you bring this session to a close? Hein? You know, I mean, I'll ask you a very specific question. Has the restaurant industry gone over the worst, you think? Is order direct, or you know cloud kitchen business as well as a direct ordering business take off in a way that is self-sustaining? And third, are we going to see people coming out of hotel management institutes or more whom you'll love to hire in a restaurant, not wait for them to be trained by Taj or Oberoi?
You ask too many questions at a time, and at my age, I won't remember all of them together. But
let's
let
begin with the beginning, you know, but you out of the danger zone? You know?
No, I think we are definitely out of the worst. I think there is no doubt in my mind, in 3 decades of my career, and I have seen the Gulf War of 91 had some impact. There was nothing even remotely close to what we have seen. I was in the thick of action during 26/11, but we bounced back in a week's time. This is something totally different. And I think we are totally out of it. And with the accelerated pace of vaccination, this can only get better. I think it is also very important. I think people have realized that it is the collective responsibility of people and the restaurants to ensure COVID protocol adherence. That's number one. What is the way ahead? I have always been optimistic about this trade for a simple reason. Eating out is never going to be out of fashion. Reason being, eating out is not only about topping your tummy. It is about celebration. It is about having fun. It is probably the simplest form to celebrate. Birthday hai, chalo kahin khane chalte hain. Office mein kisi ka promotion hua, khane chalte hain. Deal crack hua, khane chalte hain. Inhe bhi bolte hain, but main khana bol raha hun. So that is why I feel this business is not going to be out of fashion. What has happened? That the formats and the pace of growth in the trade has been very phenomenal over last one decade, thanks to all the dollar dumping and the peas coming in. In a way, there is nothing wrong with that. But I think this pandemic break has given us a reality check. And I think lots of entrepreneurs are realizing the futility of being in a mad rat race. You do things that you feel about doing, not what you think Excel is telling you to do. This business is to be done from the heart, not from Excel sheet. So that's number 3. About the hotel management, I think there is a dire need to upgrade the course material, and that can only happen if educators and the industry stalwarts come together for a common purpose of creating a better pipeline of talent for the trade. It is very possible. Last thing for the students I must say is, the hotel management course, while it opens several avenues for you, it gives you a foothold. Your growth is not dependent on the degree you hold. It depends on the amount of upskilling and learning you do. The difference between people, so if 10 people start as management trainee, there is only one who becomes a managing director. And that one defining thing that changes it is that person would have constantly upskilled, upgraded his knowledge. You have to move beyond. Sorry, I'm taking a little longer, but I feel very strongly about another thing amongst the hotel management professionals. We think that whatever is our operating area, whether F&B, kitchen, housekeeping, front office, that is the begin all and end of the world. That's the gravest mistake you can make. That is something that you will know, that is your domain expertise. But if you really want to hit the big league, learn how business is conducted and not how department is run. Department running is very critical because that is your bread and butter. But if you really want to excel in life, you must learn how this work that you're doing in your arena translates into business. If you don't acquire that knowledge at some point of time, you'll become redundant. It's like anybody. An engineer can become engineer in chief, chief engineer, whatever they are called. Beyond that, what? You know,
yeah,
so,
it's
so these are a few things that come to my mind.
You know, there's some young chefs here, you know. My advice is that you should, you know, upskill and also learn to diversify, you know. That's one thing I learned in journalism. You know, for instance, the role that I have now is about 80% management, you know, then 20%, I mean, I hardly find time to write anymore.
So good. Now, instead of writing, you read.
Yeah, exactly.
So, that's a good change. So, the only difference is you're not reading news.
Yeah.
You'll be reading Excel sheets and MIS.
Yes, that's right. I'm learning how to do that. Anyway, you know, thank you so much. It was a great session. I think we see Mr. Arun Singh here. I hope some of the takeaway messages for the education sector has registered. His institute is in fact right next door.
I'm sorry, Mr. Singh, if I exceeded my brief.
No. He's always open to ideas, you know. I'll request Mr. Dadu, please, and Chef Gill, if you can, felicitate our panelists, please, Ajayye, the rest, Mridu will handle the rest of the session.
Well, as Anuragji just mentioned, that eating out will never go out of fashion. Gastronomy will never go out of fashion. So the restaurants, which wore a deserted look just a few months back, are brimming with action and business. So the only constant now will be to reimagine, reconstruct, upgrade, evolve, adapt in order to survive. Thank you so much, all our panelists, for your insights and for suggesting the way forward. And now I request Chef Gill to felicitate, present memento to Anuragji first. Mr. Anurag Katyar. Shri Amit Bagga. I request Hari Daduji to present memento to Shri Amit Bagga. And one for Udit Kukreja. Sir, thank you so much once again. Thanks to Sorishi for conducting the sessions. Let's have a group photograph.